Hello, everybody. Welcome back to the WTF1 podcast, the British Grand Prix edition. And sadly, myself and Tommy, of course, is with me once again. Hello, Tommy.
Hello.
We're not coming off the buzz of actually having been to Silverstone, which is a very weird feeling, isn't it? It's not something that we're used to.
No, it was very weird watching from home, especially because I'm not very far from the circuit either. And just a very weird, I think this was the first one of the year. Don't get me wrong, like no offense to Austria in particular, because obviously the Dutch fans there are absolutely incredible. But I think because, you know, we go to Silverstone every year and you really expect fans there, it did feel very strange. And the fact that you did have Lewis winning in such an incredible way, I couldn't help but feel my days, what an atmosphere that would have been for those final laps.
That would have been ridiculous. I remember just sat there watching the race and I genuinely started screaming because I was looking at the Delta. I'm not going to give myself, you know, credit. Well, I'm going to give myself a little bit of credit. I was watching the time deltas and I saw Bottas falling away from Verstappen and I thought, okay, look, he's losing a bit of time. But then I saw it coming down every second. And I was like, oh my God, something's wrong with Bottas. Then 5 seconds later, boom, camera, nice shot. Anyway, yeah, it was weird, wasn't it? It wasn't even a tale of two halves. It was a tale of 97% and 3%.
Indeed, but we'll go into it with your race review. But yes, it was rather memorable, which will never be forgotten.
Yes. Three-word race reviews. D.Singh, Lewis, Lucky Hamilton.
No.
Sterinyosug, Tires Left Chat. Jazz Simj, Red Bull effed up. And RocketDeckers_sad for Hulkenberg. As we run down those, D.Singh, completely disagree. With Lewis Lucky Hamilton and people, I can already feel them typing, oh my God, it's because you're British, you're Lewis fanboy. We're not. If you watch any of our content, you'll know that both myself and Tommy couldn't give a stuff if Hamilton wins or not.
Indeed.
Sterinyosug, Tires Left Chat, they very much did. Rebel left up. I wouldn't agree with that either. Yeah, I'm inclined not to agree with that. And sad for Hulkenberg, I think we can all say that we agree with that one. But my three-word race review, we'll kick things off with me. Iconic, but boring. Now, what I mean by this is that race will never be forgotten. It will be down in the history books as, well, correct me if I'm wrong, the only time anyone's ever won with a puncture or with three wheels.
Indeed.
Is that right, Tommy?
Indeed, yes.
Okay, perfect. Cool. Awesome. We got through the fact checker. Lovely. but most of the race was completely and utterly dull, at least for the fight for the lead. The midfield battle was actually quite interesting. But, you know, when you look at iconic races throughout the years, it's always a fight for the lead. You don't really look back at a race and go, oh my God, that was iconic because there was a fight for seventh. But this one will go down because of the way it ended, which was just the most bizarre thing I think I've ever seen.
Yeah, it really will. I agree with you on the iconic side. Boring, it was definitely borderline boring. I mean, you know, boring.
I'm not complaining. I've already said this year, I'm not complaining.
Yeah. No. Boring in the context of good Formula One races. Yes. I guess I'm sure that's
it was very much a nil-nil draw for most of it.
Yeah.
You can still appreciate the sport, but there weren't really any goals, were there?
Yeah, midfield battles, unfortunately, midfield battles is what we've just come to expect now with Mercedes and Verstappen just going off into the distance because it did very much, it did seem that way. But totally agree with the iconic thing because it's going to be one of those races where regardless of everything else that went on, everyone will remember that moment and it's going to be played on highlight reels forever. It's going to be in every like F1 montage from now on. a bit like so thinking of a couple of examples, they like to replay classic races, don't they, on a lot of things, and they do on YouTube as well.
Yeah.
And I feel like this is going to be one where people will vote for it and want to see it again. And then in 10 years, 20 years time, and just forget just how dull the rest of the race actually was. Because the examples I can think of is, you know, the it was a bit before my time, but Mansell and Senna, where they were sparking down Catalunya.
Yeah.
That's like iconic F1 moment that's in every highlights. Everyone talks about it all the time, that it's like that is the 90s. But actually, that race wasn't particularly interesting, really. Same with the Prost Senna thing in Japan. Not a lot of action for much of the race. So it will be like one of those things where the whole race isn't an absolute banger, but that moment will just go down in the history books forever.
And that's the thing with motorsport. And to be fair, when you look at, I hate to liken it to football and stuff because I'm not a massive football fan, but you know, in terms of what like matches, you know, you don't have goals every 5 minutes. You don't have thrilling action throughout the entirety of the 90 minutes of football or whatever sport you're watching. And motorsport's no exception to that, because that's the kind of moments we live for as Formula One fans. We don't expect wheel-to-wheel battles for first place throughout the entire race, but moments like that where you'll just go, as you say, you know, you'll be chatting to a mate and, do you remember that British Grand Prix when Hamilton won on three wheels and had to drive half a lap to beat Verstappen? It might be forgotten as we continue down the years how many seconds and how dominating that Mercedes really was. But let's dive into some questions. At Kirsten_creep, why was it allowed that Lewis finished the race on those wheels? Should that not be unsafe? Obviously, a lot of the Hamilton haters jumping on this bandwagon, thinking that it was, you know, potentially unsafe, the fact he was driving with a puncture. But I guess the way I saw it and the way probably the stewards saw it was that it wasn't actually particularly unsafe, in the sense that the way in which the tyre was degrading and delaminating wasn't the way that we've seen it before, where, you know, it's bodywork and debris going everywhere. Had that been the case, then I think the stewards would have basically looked into it, because I think it's similar to what, was it Giovinazzi did in practice, where he spun and then he just came back to the pit so quickly and there was debris everywhere.
Yeah, and they red flagged that, didn't they? Mm. But it wasn't, yeah, I don't think that tyre was delaminating to the point, and he wasn't like shedding bodywork and stuff. It's funny, that one, because this is a bit, for me, this is just really clutching at straws. And don't get me wrong, like you said earlier, especially because Verstappen and Leclerc were the next two down the road, we would have loved to have seen them winning the race, especially for the championship. Not that they have any chance, but we would have loved to have seen a different winner than a Mercedes. However, what's the guy meant to do? He's retired. He's got a puncture on the final lap. People seem to think it's a lap and a half ago. No, it was the final lap.
Yeah.
And he's not going to pull over and just retire and go, oh, well, he's going to go to the finish.
No driver is going to pull over.
Exactly. And ironically, well, for a start, Perez did that, didn't he, in Austria when his front wing failed, and there was no cause for...
And that was more dangerous. Him.
Yeah, because the he's
front
having
wing was
a
hanging
lot.
Off.
Yeah, exactly. And also, ironically, the only thing he could have done was pit, but then he wouldn't have been able to pit because he would have probably been even more controversial, because he would have corner cut because of the way that pit lane is. So the only thing he could really do was drive to the line, which he did, and he won. So it's just the way it is.
Yeah, completely. And as you say, it is clutching at straws. It was, you know, no other driver, I don't think, would have had calls for penalties, disqualification, all that good stuff, than Lewis Hamilton. I don't know what it is about him that attracts such negativity, because in my eyes, and again, I'm not a Lewis fanboy or anything like that, but I feel like the way in which he drove that car back to the pits was nothing short of astonishing. The fact that he was able to keep that tyre in check in the way that he did, I know obviously some of it might be luck, some of it might be good fortune, but there's some drivers that in that situation would have gone too fast, blown up the front left, and then potentially been out of the race. That's how I see it anyway, because the way in which he saw the car immediately on that front left start to go away, and then he was on the radio. And again, props to Mercedes as well for the way in which they dealt with that situation, where it was so calm and so composed. When you look back to Germany, when they were trying to get him to pit, then it's completely different sort of thing. You know, in, you know, they had that side of things, which was a lot more hectic, and, you know, it unsettles the driver. But it was a very different approach. Not something that I really expected from Lewis or Mercedes, really, was was just, you know, Verstappen's 20 seconds, 18, 16. You know, it must have been quite unsettling for Lewis to hear that gap coming down so quickly. But fortunately for him, he was pretty much home.
It was really weird, wasn't it, that no other cars were really around when he was doing his lap? Because if you watch the onboard, yeah, it's very weird because it's so calm. They're just talking him through. There seems to be no real worry. They're looking at the gap all the time. There's no panic of like, I'm going to lose this race. He just doing what he needs to do. It's funny, though, that I guess you can argue that he was fortunate, and he has admitted this himself, that if the tyre had gone when he was going into Copse or Beckett's or something, it could have been a huge accident. Look at Kvyat when his tyre went. So that is fortunate, I guess, that he got the puncture where he did. But it is funny that a driver that's dominated the weekend, stuck it on pole by 0.3, led every single lap, and then is one of only a handful of drivers to get a puncture, is considered lucky.
Yeah.
If you put it that way, it's not really lucky.
Has there been any clarification on the tyres? Because there's been talk of the fact that there was debris and potentially from Kimi Raikkonen.
There's been not as time of recording.
So, no, not as time of recording.
Because it is weird, isn't it? Because
we've had it before, haven't we, from Silverstone tyres?
We have. And it's obviously, these cars now are putting huge stress on the tyres because they're flat out through ridiculous corners that shouldn't be flat out in normal race cars, even very quick race cars. And so it puts a huge stress on the tyres. And also, we have the problem where there was obviously a safety cars, so they probably went a little bit longer on the tyres than they would have expected because they pitted a little bit earlier. So that's putting more stress on the tyres.
Yeah, very true.
But then, like you say, they were saying there was vibrations, but also at the same time, there was debris from Kimi Raikkonen's car, which redded his front wing and knocked debris everywhere. So I'm not sure. Like, I think it might have been Hamilton that said he was convinced it was debris, not a tyre failure. But yeah, Pirelli haven't said yet, so...
No, because there wasn't cuts in Verstappen's tyres as well, and that's what I read anyway. So yeah, it seems like it's leaning towards the debris side of things rather than what we saw in 2013, where it was just tyres failing left, right, and centre, where they were just exploding. So interesting. But back to Kirsten's question very quickly. I don't think Lewis did anything wrong, and if anything, it was a really, fortunate that it blew up where it did, but not fortunate in the fact that he won, because he did absolutely everything he needed to win. I think that's fair to say, right?
Indeed.
Okay, next question. Alex does F1 stuff. Knowing that Hamilton's tyres were in a similar shape to Bottas's, why would you think Red Bull came into the pits after Bottas's puncture? They could have gambled and gained 7 extra points today. Instead, they played it safe and gained an extra 1. And that kind of ties in again with the 3-word race review of Jazz Simge saying Red Bull effed up. My opinion on this is that Red Bull didn't mess up. If anything, the funny thing is, I guarantee if Verstappen stayed out, Hamilton went on to win the race and Verstappen's tyre blew up, they'd be saying, why the hell didn't Red Bull pit Verstappen? So he had the cushion.
Yeah, he had the cushion to Leclerc, didn't he? And he wasn't racing Mercedes.
He had the cushion to, he had the cushion to behind. But Red Bull probably heard as well Mercedes saying to Hamilton, just take it easy, bring the car home. So, like, what? It's easy to say that, you could have won the race. But when you look at it like that, Red Bull were playing that's probably, in their heads, that's probably a 5% chance that Hamilton's tyre is going to blow up as well within one lap of the end. So,
yeah.
For them, it's a much safer route to go down for the fastest lap. And even Verstappen said in an interview afterwards that, look, is it unlucky or is it lucky? Because Bottas's tyre blew up and they were nowhere near. So I think it's easy to say that Red Bull messed up. And yes, they could have won the race. And maybe they should have taken that risk. But
it's all
for
hindsight.
Me, it just doesn't... It wouldn't make sense. Yeah, exactly. It's all hindsight.
Yeah, you're right. I think Max summed up perfectly in his interview that said, I'm unlucky because if I hadn't have pitted, there would have been a chance that I could have won the race, but equally his tyre might have blown up as well and he might not have even finished in the top 10. And then equally, he was fortunate that Bottas's tyre went, like you said, because it meant that he managed to finish ahead of a Mercedes when no one could get anywhere near them because they were absolutely untouchable all weekend. And it's easy to say that Hamilton's tyre was going to go, but how many races have we seen where someone has, say, for example, Bottas having a car failure, for example, they always go, oh, Lewis Hamilton might have a car failure now, and it never happens.
Exactly.
And this time it did, but it wasn't a guaranteed thing that it was going to happen. It was surprising. So one thing that was surprising, though, which a few people mentioned, is how chill Verstappen was afterwards, because I think 2 or 3 years ago, this maybe shows that he's matured a lot as a driver, he might have shown a bit more frustration
towards
thinking a win got away from him and stuff. And he was,
I mean, he was effing and blinding quite a bit down the radio, but
on the radio. But I mean, in terms of an interview afterwards, going, well, I can't begrudge my team for doing it. We got extra points. Although there was an interesting comment, I cannot remember. There's a few actually that we got in replies. I can't remember who said it now, but people were saying that Verstappen, at the end of the day, he's now picked up good points and an extra point for fastest lap. And with the uncertainty of like COVID and stuff, I mean, it's not out of the question because of what happened to Perez that people could be getting subbed and stuff. So
God,
he needs every point
that
he can.
Like,
so
Hamilton getting COVID or something. And then
exactly.
It would just be ridiculous. Obviously, because we don't wish that on anyone.
No, of course
not.
And
for people that haven't seen IBR, obviously, we send our well wishes to Sergio. Hope he gets better, although it seemed like he had no symptoms anyway from the video, which is great to hear. But as you say, yeah, it is that uncertainty that a driver might not be able to race for a couple of races, which is another very strange outlook on the championship that we've never had before.
Indeed. So maybe... You know, you've got to think that they need to pick up every point they can. And especially, they're not racing Mercedes, are they? Realistically, they're racing the midfield.
Yeah, Racing Point and Ferrari potentially. But yeah, you just wonder what people would say if like Bottas won the championship because Hamilton couldn't race for two races. Oh my God. I don't even want to go down that route. I hope everyone stays healthy and we don't have to deal with those discussions.
100%.
Finally on this matter, Fuller_F1 says, when was the last time the winner won with a puncture across the line? And that is never.
Indeed. Yeah, we've had a few crazy moments, haven't we, at the finish.
Pushing a car across the line and stuff like that, but never three wheels.
It is one thing I was thinking of as well, while on the subject where we've been saying, oh, it's lucky that Hamilton always gets this luck and does this. It is funny, isn't it, how all the best drivers have these iconic moments. thinking Senna in Brazil when his gearbox was failing and it was raining. And he ended up winning the race. Schumi was stuck in fifth gear, I think it was, and he still finished second. Those are the drives that everyone's going to remember
surprised
from
didn't
these.
Bring up Damon Hill then as well.
No. Oh no, we don't talk about his arrows moment. but yeah, those moments from great champions happen, and it's because they dominate races, and even when things go against them, they still get the job done.
Exactly.
Regardless of if you think it's lucky or fortunate, they still get it done. And this is just another thing that's going to go on Hamilton's record and be in all his highlights reels, showing what a great driver he was, just like Senna, just like Schumacher, just like all the other greats. So,
absolutely. Indeed. And you have to give a shout. Well, it's not a shout out, but a little mention to Bottas and how unlucky he got, because he got his puncture right at the start of the lap and then had to trundle all the way around with a puncture, which pretty much... Well, it feels like we're waving goodbye to Bottas's championship chances already, which is quite sad.
Because
25 point swing is huge in the matter of this championship and not knowing how far we're going to go. Right, Tommy, your three word race review. Hit me up.
Mercedes, then midfield.
Ooh.
So this is kind of 2 points in one, really. We've already mentioned it to a point, but thank goodness for the midfield because it made the race exciting.
Yeah.
The fact that the midfield now is a very weird one because it's Mercedes, Verstappen, everyone else. It used to be Mercedes, Ferrari and Red Bull. Then you had the midfield and then Williams. But now it seems, especially this race, it wasn't quite as 2x2 as you normally get. You had Red Bull, Ferrari, McLaren, Racing Point, Renault all together. And one, that's really good for the championship. But the second point here is that it's very bad news for Alex Albon, because yes. I was thinking about this, and because the midfield is so close now, his deficit to Max Verstappen looks... I'm not defending him. He needs to do better, and he has not been having a good time. There's no getting around the fact.
Yeah.
But the gap is certainly very exaggerated in terms of a result, because I saw this, that Bottas was 0.3 behind Hamilton in qualifying.
Yeah.
And obviously we're always saying what a perfect number two driver Bottas is to Hamilton. And he's quick enough to get second place, but he's in a Mercedes. And that gap between those two is second and first. And Albon was slightly more, but 0.37 slower than Verstappen. And Max is third, Alex is 12th. So it really does, it's not doing him any favours, but he needs to pick up the pace.
He absolutely does. And speaking of Albon, let's talk about the collision that he had with Kevin Magnussen at the last corner, which is very weird. I don't think we expected a chat about a collision there, but obviously Magnussen getting all out of shape, going through the penultimate corner, getting up on the sausage curb. Albon, who clearly, you know, has a point to prove, wants to make his way up as far as he possibly can, goes for the move up the inside. As soon as he probably goes for it, he goes, why on earth am I here? Magnussen, you know, Magnussen, he's Kevin Magnussen. You know, he's not exactly the a man to give a huge amount of room. We know that from previous. And, well, he kind of shuts the door. And in some ways, I kind of get it. I get why he's done that, because why would Albon risk such a move up the inside? And for me, I think I still think it was a racing instant, just purely how alongside Alex Albon was. But at the same time, it was just very reckless. And again, not having that patience, like he didn't have the patience with Hamilton, although obviously we've spoken about the fact that Red Bull were saying that was his only opportunity in Austria to try and get past Hamilton. But again, just not having that patience to wait maybe a few more corners to then get him down Wellington Straight.
That's unfortunately boring for the viewers, because I have exactly the same opinion. I was hoping that we might have a different opinion. It'd be spicy, but I cannot agree more. That it's, for me, it's my definition of a racing incident, where I don't feel like you should be penalising everyone as soon as there's contact. But for me, it's more Albon's fault, because he's going into a gap that's always going to close. He needs to think about who he's racing against, and it just seemed so desperate into a corner that it's not too wide, that corner. You look at the way
it's
you
even less
take
wide
that
now,
corner,
isn't it? Because there's gravel there this year.
Exactly. You have to, it's not the way the corner is, it's not the kind of corner you can go too wide in. So I see that he saw the mistake and dived up the inside, but like you say, immediately he was probably going, oh dear, I shouldn't have done this. And then, just another incident he doesn't need right now.
And he was very lucky as well. If we're talking about luck in this podcast and Hamilton being lucky, Albon is extremely lucky that his front left was still attached to his car. We've seen much less break a steering arm this year. So, I'm not on the wagon at all of Alex Albon to be replaced or anything like that. But there's clearly something fundamentally wrong with, firstly, Alex Albon's demeanour within the team and what he feels he has to be doing. And I just don't feel like he's getting enough support from Red Bull. Obviously, I'm not on the inside. I'm literally just speculating. But what else could it possibly be where we're seeing almost a carbon copy now of Gasly and Albon both struggling immensely at Red Bull? What is the fundamental issue that's going on in that team to not allow a second driver to perform? It just doesn't make any sense.
Yeah, I'm probably not the best person to talk about it.
Because what happened is just the best man ever, and everyone else is rubbish.
But at the same time, Verstappen, you know, we talk about Charles Leclerc's incredible drive or Hamilton's incredible drive, and we don't for a second think that the other car is being, I'm not saying you think he's being sabotaged. There's
No, not at all.
Yeah. And I don't think anyone can seriously say that a team would sabotage their own car. I personally agree that Red Bull there's no doubt that Red Bull are putting all their support behind Verstappen, and the car will be built for him now because he's the number one driver and has proved why he would be the number one driver. I think the car just must be an absolute handful to drive. I don't know if anyone's looked into if Verstappen has a particularly unique driving style or, but we've seen it with Fernando Alonso and his teammates where as soon as you're up against him, you just can't get anywhere near him. And whether that's the fact that Verstappen, like Alonso, demands so much of the team to be built around him, getting the best out of the car. We're in this stage now where Verstappen very rarely makes the mistakes he used to and seems to just manage to get the peak out of the car every single race. So even when Albon is 0.3 off, everyone's going, this isn't good enough.
Yeah, so, don't get me wrong. The Red Bull does look like a massive handful to drive, and maybe it is. And I'm going to give a shout out to Tomo F1 for saying this, but he was saying to me, I think it was yesterday, about, and it makes sense really, that he thinks that, you know, if anybody was to go in the Mercedes, they could do a similar job to what Bottas is doing. Just purely how the Mercedes looks like it handles. It's planted. It looks simple to drive. Obviously, it's not. No punter could go in there. But the people on the grid, he reckons that a lot of people would be able to do a similar job to Bottas in terms of number two driver. However, yep. The Red Bull, it looks like it's got a ceiling of potential that's somewhere near the Mercedes. But actually getting to that is so much harder. And it seems like the car is so much more difficult to set up. And that's where, you know, a newer driver, an Albon or a Gasly, that maybe doesn't have that adaptability in their core yet, isn't able to do what Verstappen is doing. And maybe that is down to the driving style and the specific requirements to drive that Red Bull, because it does look ridiculously difficult to drive. I mean, Verstappen crashed it on the blooming, not even the formation lap, the drive round to the grid. So it is an interesting point, isn't it, that the Red Bull just, it takes a specific human to make sure that that gets anywhere near the front.
Indeed. And it is, like you say, it, like we were saying earlier, the midfield being so close really does exaggerate the gap between getting it right and getting it wrong, because it's so close now. And yeah, it's interesting though that they have now brought in Daniel Ricciardo's old engineer, as in he left after Ricciardo left the team to do another role at the factory, I think, Simon right. Rennie. And yeah. Since then, I don't know. I don't want to for a second say that it was all down to the engineer, but they've obviously felt that they need a more experienced engineer with that second driver to be able to help them perform. And this was the first weekend where Simon Rennie's actually come back. But unfortunately, because Albon didn't qualify well and made mistakes, we didn't really get to see that in action. So I think that's going to be an interesting thing to see if that does help him perform better.
Fingers crossed. Drewby2400 says, why does everyone refuse to bash Albon the same way they bashed Gasly? Because Gasly's performances were worse than Albon's, yeah, statistically and also on the track. You can see that there was something holding back Gasly getting confidence in that car. At least Albon has shown glimpses of potential. He hasn't been able to really hook into qualifying just yet, and as you said, Tommy, just recently, that, you know, his performances are now being scrutinized even more, because an off qualifying will get you knocked out of Q2, which is crazy to think, and a Red Bull was not supposed to be there. So I think if it continues this way, Albon will get the same bashing as what Gasly gets. I think that everyone's seen it happen to Gasly and maybe are a little bit more sort of understanding that it's not as easy as it seems to just get in the car and be quick. I don't know, but either way, I don't think Albon's got a huge amount of time left before things start to get maybe a little bit worse for him.
Speaking from our side, I don't think that, I know this is a general comment, but, you know, Gasly performed poorly in the Red Bull compared to Max Verstappen. And for example, in ABCDEF1, we graded him rather harshly. And Albon has no doubt done the same thing, and we've graded him harshly. There's no denying that there are drivers that certain people see in a better light, because, you know, I'm sure fans will have been very endeared by Alex Albon from the way he was during the virtual GPs and being on streams with everyone.
Yeah,
no doubt to some fans, they feel like they can't be harsh on him because he does seem like this guy that you don't want to
kind of
you're just like, oh, the poor guy, like he deserves better. But like you say, like he deserves the criticism he's getting at the moment, and he himself will know he needs to pick it up and get back to where he should be.
Yeah, and he knows that. You can see that in the interviews where he just looks inconsolable. And, you know, he's not looking at the interviewer. He's kind of looking down. He's like, yeah.
Rubbing his eye, I noticed, yeah.
And it's sad to see, because we've seen that before. Who was it? Oh, was it Kvyat? There was a driver that's on the grid that kind of got into a rut. Or maybe it was Gasly, I'm thinking of. I'm not sure.
Which Red Bull driver was it?
Yeah, I know.
Which of Verstappen's teammate was it?
Pretty much. It was one of the Red Bull guys, you know, and you could just see it happening, and it's just so sad. And you just kind of want to reach out and hug them.
Yeah.
But yeah, we'll see how it unfolds. And finally on it, Hamilton SAFC. How long before Albon is swapped? I don't think that's going to happen personally this year. Unless he literally starts not scoring any points. I don't see them doing another Gasly personally.
It's weird. I've been following the Red Bull junior team for forever. And it's interesting to me how much Daniel Ricciardo leaving has really screwed them. It's unbelievable that I remember the Red Bull junior team being so strong that they couldn't even promote Da Costa into a Toro Rosso, who was clearly an incredible racing driver and deserved to be in Formula One, because there was so much talent in that pool and they couldn't promote it. And now they've got a case where the second driver at Red Bull isn't performing. The two drivers in the AlphaTauri, formerly Toro Rosso, are both been fired from Red Bull. Kvyat even completely fired from Red Bull and came back to Formula One with them. And they're both older than the Red Bull team. It's very weird, weird situation. I mean, for me, Red Bull need need great drivers. And the problem is with Red Bull is you can say about them being promoted too early, but Sebastian Vettel was promoted and he delivered. Max Verstappen was promoted and he delivered. And because those guys were so good, that's the kind of level that Red Bull expect. So when someone comes in and they're not like that, people ask questions. And it is a difficult situation. We've said it many times on the podcast that we all want to see the best Formula One drivers in F1. But then when someone gets... And then it's almost like the other extreme is Red Bull, where they go, well, okay, we only want the best drivers in F1. And if you're not Max Verstappen level, you're gone.
Yeah.
So,
and it's unrealistic expectations to think that you can get just another Max Verstappen in the team. And do you even want another Max Verstappen in the team?
Exactly. They need need experience. They need, they could do with someone like, you know, they used to have obviously Mark Webber in that second seat, who maybe wasn't, he did push for the championship a bit and would take wins. And he obviously brought that huge experience with them. But the way the Red Bull program works now, them kind of hiring someone like a Sergio Perez or something, it seems so unlikely, because it's not the way they do their work with the junior team.
No, it's not. The curious case of Red Bull.
Do you think Gasly, because we've not really spoken about how amazing Gasly was in this race.
We haven't, no. Let's give him a quick shout out.
What a performance. And do you think he might have been... Do you think maybe he should have been given more time now?
So
hard to say, isn't it?
It is so difficult, because he's already proven himself at Toro Rosso or AlphaTauri, whatever you want to call them. So clearly whatever was going on at Red Bull, there was no way that it was really going to pick up anytime soon. It didn't look that way anyway. Gasly was, you know, a finished man. Yeah. It was horrible to see. So I think it was the right thing for them to do. And I think Gasly, the way in which he's reacted, come back, got straight back into that team, has saved his F1 career because of the fact that, you know, he's pumping in these amazing performances. You know, getting past Vettel in a Ferrari was very odd to watch, considering that was for position. I think if anywhere Gasly needs to go somewhere else, because whatever's going on in that Red Bull team doesn't work for him.
Ordinarily, if you completely take out the equation that Gasly was ever once in that team, do you not think they'd be promoting him straight away based on that performance?
Yes, yeah,
which is
sure.
really weird. Which is really weird to think, isn't it? But I think it's even more embarrassing for them to swap them
again.
Back again. And
it just
the whole thing is a bit
it,
of
yeah.
a mess, really. They are in a bit of a mess with their whole junior setup. It's going to be interesting to see how the rest of the season pans out, because there's no doubt Albon is under pressure.
It's sad. I just want to see him do well, you know? It's difficult, but
yeah.
I genuinely believe Red Bull need to look at what's going on, and it's not at driver level. It goes deeper than that, and they need to work it out, because not since Danny Ric have we seen a teammate perform well with Verstappen. So,
yeah.
Right, moving on to the bit better news, a bit more happy, or well, kind of, until Sunday.
Kind of.
Was, of course, Nico Hülkenberg. I did enjoy that hashtag, to be fair. And what a return it was for him. You know, he probably didn't even know he was going to be racing Thursday morning. Then he gets the call in the afternoon, flies over, gets a seat fitting, does an hour in the simulator to pretty much get used to the controls again, remember how to drive an F1 car. Then he had a COVID test, didn't he? Then he was back at the sim. Then he was basically an FP1. And
right.
Yeah, crazy, ridiculous. And then obviously he didn't race, which is just heartbreaking.
He's lucky that Racing Point, in a way, I don't know how it would have worked, say it had been for Ferrari or even a UK team based a little bit further away, but the fact that the Racing Point factory
literally
is at
door,
Silverstone,
yeah.
He could obviously go there, have his COVID test, and then it's like a 5-minute walk, seat fitting, because he was doing his seat fitting till about 2 a.m. according to the stuff that he'd written. So it all was very last minute, but you've got to applaud the turnaround, because when it was happening, I don't know about you, but I thought there's absolutely no way he's going to be in the car in FP1. Because he wasn't even announced when FP1 was pretty much about to start. And then you see him running down the paddock in Racing Point gear. It's crazy how last minute. I don't remember a driver change ever being that last minute and rushed. It's mad.
Yeah, it was a ridiculous turnaround, wasn't it? The fact that his name wasn't changed on the leaderboard until about 5 minutes before FP1. And then I think there was a big confusion about the driver number as well. I think it was 65,000 at one point and his name was Perez. But either way, it was great to see him back. I think there was a unanimous feeling of just happiness that Hülkenberg, you know, his career wasn't over. As much as we, you know, he has had opportunities to get podiums and stuff, he's clearly proved himself enough to deserve a spot on the grid. I think that's without saying. And I know that some people have been saying, oh, you know, maybe he'll get a seat at Williams, but people are forgetting that he's already had chats with Williams. And as far as I'm aware, there wasn't enough money for him and he doesn't really want to be tootling around the back. So it clearly isn't the right fit for Hülkenberg if he did want to get back onto F1. I don't know if you have anything to add on that, Tommy.
Yeah, I thought the same. It is funny that obviously there's huge pressure on the fact that there was so much talk, especially when Stroll banged it in first in FP1 or 2, I can't remember which one it was now,
yeah.
FP2. They were very disappointing, actually, Racing Point, their pace, when
they were
going to be best of the rest behind Mercedes. But yeah, it's a massive shame he didn't start, but it did look like after all the kind of problems that he'd had, that he'd end up driving this incredible car at Silverstone that is probably the second best car in F1. and he would have a real chance at a podium. But
I'm just kind of glad they were off the pace. It made me feel a little bit better about Hülkenberg not driving, because he probably would have finished on the outskirts of the points and maybe even out of the points, and it would have been quite a... Because I mean, Stroll finished ninth, didn't he, in the end? So
yeah, they were nowhere near what I expected them to be.
Yeah. Maddie Rocks says, why didn't Racing Point try to fix Hulk's car so he could get used to the track and the car at race pace, considering that he is most likely to race at the next one as well? Or is it simply against the rules to take part in the race after a certain amount of time has passed since the start? I don't think that's a thing, is it? They can.
I don't believe so. I'm sure you can start. Either way, the kind of the problem, it wasn't like a suspension problem, yeah, or something. It was fundamental engine
power
yeah, unit. It sounds very Hülkenberg how unlucky it was that it was something to do with a bolt had sheared and then got stuck somewhere, and then it meant that the engine wouldn't tick over, so they couldn't even start it. But I did read ironically that the part was a Mercedes part.
Wow. Sabotage. Yeah, that's
gutting.
It's sad.
Gutting.
It is sad for Nico.
At least he's there next week.
People, I think we should probably address this. Some people are thinking, and to be fair, I've seen a few things saying that Racing Point might debate when the first COVID test was, and that the self-isolation could be shorter than... I don't know if you've seen this, Tommy.
Looking into it. But
yeah, that they're looking into the fact that Sergio could potentially race next weekend. But I don't personally see that happening with the strict parameters in place.
Because
as much as they have that test, surely the whatever you want to call it, the isolation starts when it's given as positive. That's how I would see it anyway.
Yeah, me too. I would be very surprised if Perez was racing, because there was even talk that he might not even race in Barcelona, is it?
That's really weird, isn't it? God. Oh, well. We'll see how it goes. I'm sure Sergio, you know, will rest up and be back for Spain, hopefully. It'd be great to see Hülkenberg have another shot and actually get on in the car. Because, you know, even his neck was, you know, you could see he was kind of struggling with his neck. And it's things that people don't even think about as well, that he was struggling with free practice, about there was a numb spot on his bum because of the way in which the car's molded, and he's a tall guy, so things are just a little bit out of place when you think that he's sitting in Sergio Perez's car, which is, you know, just a much smaller man.
He's actually really lucky that he's very similar height to Lance Stroll, that he could borrow Lance Stroll's overalls, because obviously they wouldn't have had any made for him. So yeah, Imagine them with two short drivers, he probably would have been there in a kind of just Alpine Stars bought off the shelf thing.
Well, because his helmet was pretty default, wasn't it?
Yeah, it was just the carbon fiber last minute thing. But he actually ended up with 15% of the driver of the day vote, despite not even driving, which says a lot about that vote, doesn't it?
That's like Verstappen winning it in America, wasn't it?
When he retired on lap three.
Or whatever it was. Oh, was it lap three?
I can't remember. It was something like that.
Ridiculous. Right, we move on. Well, actually, driver of the day, great little segue. Hamilton won driver of the day, which I don't think many people can dispute. I mean, there were a few good drives. Ricciardo up in P4 was a pretty stunning one for Renault. Obviously, Ocon P6.
Leclerc and Gasly.
Yeah, Leclerc dragging that horrendous car to P3. People were quite surprised I hadn't spoken about Leclerc and IBR. But look, there were many other performances that I needed to talk about. I'm not a fanboy, okay? Just passionate.
we'll talk about
it. It was a great performance from Charles. Don't get me wrong, we'll talk about it at ABCD F1. But yeah, I think Hamilton did deserve driver of the day, because he managed everything unbelievably. And the fact that he drove that car with three wheels, who else can you give it to?
It's funny that no one really likes we've said it so many times with the driver of the day, but no one really likes the boring lights to flag victory. So it takes a tyre explosion for Hamilton to get it.
Yes, absolutely. Right, Tommy, play the jingle.
Now it's time for ABCD F1.
Now, perfect. Right, let's do it. ABCD F1 time. Let's start with Lewis Hamilton, right from the top. Lewis Hamilton, A-star.
Star, easy.
Easy peasy, lemon squeezy, qualifying, pole. Although he did have a few iffy moments, but still, I think he's well within the A-star region to not be given an A because of his spin in qualifying and things like that.
Yeah, indeed. His spin in qualifying was a very strange one because I think a lot of us were like, oh, Bottas looks to have the edge here. No, 0.3 on pole.
Yeah, it's weird. I felt like all through free practice and the first couple of sessions in qualifying that Bottas could actually take pole here and potentially win the race. It looked like Hamilton was a little bit off kilter, but when it came down to it, he eventually found his form on the last lap of qualifying as Hamilton, you know, just pops in a banger. And yeah, I mean, and the race, we don't need to go any further detail into that. Valtteri Bottas.
C, I guess. It wasn't.
Wow, C.
What do you think?
C, that's a bit harsh, I think.
I don't know.
He kept Hamilton in check for the entire race until his tyre blew up.
0.3 off in qualifying.
I think he deserves a B. I think it wasn't a Bottas performance 20 seconds down the road. Obviously, he was unlucky about the explosion. But he was within... Then you can argue that he was pushing his tyres too much and that's why his front left blew up. But then Hamilton's went 2 laps later, so it's not a huge amount of difference there. I think B's a...
All right.
I think, he was a couple of seconds behind Hamilton the entire race and they were exchanging fastest laps until things went wrong for him. So
it would have been interesting to see... I don't think he did have it in him, but when Bottas, before his incident, the fact that Max was kind of closing in a little bit, I think the gap was too big.
Yeah.
But obviously if his tyre hadn't gone and they were really nursing that problem, it would have been interesting to see how that panned out. Not that I'm complaining because the end was incredible anyway.
No, it's brilliant. Charles Leclerc.
A star.
I mean, pops it P4 on the grid. Medium compound tyres in Q2, put himself on the best strategy possible, and then lugs it to P3 somehow. I did scream, not going to lie. When Bottas blew up and then Hamilton blew up, for some reason, I forgot Verstappen existed and I thought Leclerc was going to win. I genuinely stood up, started screaming, and then I was like, oh yeah, Verstappen exists. Okay, that's fine. But Leclerc might get P2.
Yeah. It's weird. His year's been a bit strange because he had two woeful races and then he's had two for me, which are probably two of the best drives all season, which was this race and the first race in Austria where he's managed to get that absolute truck of a Ferrari onto the podium.
It's a weird one, isn't it?
So, I mean, he's just proving, as long as he doesn't have these moments where he kind of does something a bit silly.
Well, he mounts his teammate, yeah.
But you got to remember, he's only in his third season, I think, in F1 now, third full season. So he will hopefully iron those out. But I mean, his pace is just unbelievable. I think this was a race where it just showed that Hamilton, call me a fanboy, but Hamilton, Verstappen and Leclerc really do seem like the class of the field.
Yeah, big statement that. Get ready for your DMs to be rife with haters.
And Danny, I mean, Danny Rick, top four, you could argue, probably the four best in F1 at the moment. So,
yeah. I mean, Lando and Sainz and Carlos, they're thereabouts. Anyway, Sebastian Vettel.
This is a tough one because he was really poor and I don't think you can excuse... Like, don't get me wrong, he had some horrendous... I mean, his practice session, his pedals weren't put on properly or something in FP2. And then it happened again in FP3. So he barely got any running. And I don't think that really helped him.
No, not at all.
Set up the car. But yeah, I mean, it was just woeful performance. Just a dreadful weekend. He himself said that he just cannot get used to this car. I mean, he doesn't have to because he won't be there much longer, I guess.
Yeah, that's very true. I think, as much as the car does look like a difficult thing, we have to compare to the teammate, and
I think it was a D or an E in every way.
So said E, D.
It's definitely E or D. It just depends how much sympathy we're going to give him for the practice.
We'll give him D.
We have not really mentioned it, but I know we kind of joked about the Lawrence Stroll thing, him giving a fist bump on the way to the grid, and a lot of people were saying, oh, well, you know, Seb knows a lot of people in F1. But I noticed there's quite a strong paddock rumour that Ted Kravitz mentioned, which is that Vettel has signed the contract with Racing Point, and the only reason it wasn't announced is because Perez wasn't at the circuit and they didn't want to kind of do it while he was trapped in a motorhome with COVID.
Yeah, fair.
So it really does look like Vettel's on his way to Racing Point and Aston Martin.
That'd be very interesting.
Cool.
God, I hope they challenge at the front. That would be amazing.
That would be great,
wouldn't it?
I would love that.
So good. Then Vettel can have his glory days again. Well, not as good as Red Bull. I don't want those kind of glory days, but
back
at the front.
Back at the front, because I think he would be rejuvenated, because he's clearly he's done with Ferrari, isn't he, in every way?
Yeah, absolutely. Verstappen.
He's a kind of a victim of his own success that you just expect him to get everything out of the car.
Yeah.
And you almost need him to beat a Mercedes to get an A star, even though you could argue what else could he have done in that race?
Yeah. Maybe he wasn't pushing as hard. Maybe because the only reason I say that is because of the team radio he sent to his teammate, where he was like, don't forget to drink and stuff. So he was kind of in quite a light-hearted mood. So I wonder if he was pushing as physically hard as he possibly could. But yeah, that's not
maybe
something
a little
I can judge
bit defeated, expected. Defeated by the gap in qualifying because it was enormous.
Yeah, it was huge. But yeah, A for Verstappen. Albon.
I saw some people saying that he should have got driver of the day and stuff, and
oh
I was like,
"Oh my god, he finished
no,
eighth in the Red Bull after crashing into Magnussen. Are you mad?"
Yeah, it's like, yeah, he made some nice overtakes, but it was his poor quality result and an incident that was more his fault, in my opinion, and I think a lot of people's opinion, especially the stewards. So
I think
it's a D, yeah.
Yeah?
Yeah, D.
Happy with that? Okay, all right. Carlos Sainz, I thought he had a very good race.
Yeah.
Had a very good start, got ahead of Lando, which was surprising. Lando had a very, very poor start. So it's difficult. Obviously, he had an explosion, poor qualifying. But yeah, I think A suits for Carlos. Just a shame about his tyre. Lando, he had a great qualifying, bad start. I feel like it's harsh to give him a B because of that, because he was with Carlos the whole time.
And I think Lando was... they were almost in a bit of a difficult situation where I think Lando felt like he was catching Carlos. Because Carlos clearly had the tyre trouble, which obviously it did end up blowing up.
We didn't even see Ricardo's move on Norris,
move,
did we?
No, we didn't. But I think Lando felt like he was being not backed up by Sainz. Obviously, he wasn't doing it on purpose, but because of not being able to get close enough, that he was kind of falling into the traps of Ricardo when he felt like he could have got ahead. I think it's an A as well. I think that those two are just really solid, and it's nice to see Lando now being able to kind of match Carlos in race pace as well.
Yeah, absolutely.
Which I don't think he was doing last year. So.
And Lando is firmly heading his way, like securing his spot around the P4 area, isn't he? He's
mad.
Doing very, very well indeed.
P4 Lando. After, because it was almost in this kind of new era, you expect the top six to be locked out by Red Bull, Ferrari, and Mercedes.
Yeah.
So you're kind of seventh is best, and after four races to be P4 is pretty mad.
Let me just look it up.
He's P4. He's still fourth. Yeah.
Yeah, he's got 36 points just ahead of Charles Leclerc. Unbelievable scenes.
After four races, that's dead impressive.
That is very good. Right. Ricardo. A star.
Yeah, he's brilliant.
Yeah, great race from him. Unbelievable. Renault just looked really strong. Even Ocon wasn't too far behind Ricardo when you compare it to the first few races where he seemed to be lacking quite a bit of pace. So Esteban hopefully coming good. He needs to start beating Ricardo at some point. That would be good for his resume, wouldn't it? But
yeah, because I know Ricardo is obviously extremely highly rated, but we can't forget how extremely highly rated Esteban Ocon is as well.
Yeah, when you think that he was on the same level as Perez. So maybe it'll just take him a few more races. But he's performing well enough, I think, within that Renault Ocon to just settle himself into the team in his two-year contract. Gasly, ace.
A-star, a superb.
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 Chef's kiss.
One of the drivers of the day for me. He made some good moves as well.
Yeah,
he just looks so good in that AlphaTauri. He loves that AlphaTauri or Toro Rosso, doesn't he?
He does. He really does. Kvyat.
Oh, this is difficult.
Yeah, it wasn't his fault, was it?
Wasn't his fault.
Where was he running in comparison to Gasly at the time?
Oh, you put me on the spot there, and I genuinely can't remember. I don't think, because I think Gasly definitely outqualified him, because Gasly almost made Q3, but was 0.000, wasn't he? Making it.
Okay.
C. I think C is fair, because it wasn't his fault.
C. I was going to say B maybe, but I don't know.
I don't think he's. It's one of those things.
All right, we'll go with C.
All right,
cool. Hulkenberg, A star.
Driver of the day. His drive to the circuit in the morning was superb.
We're giving him an A star. I don't care. Put it on the sheet.
Give him an A star.
We are.
No,
unbelievable performance.
A B.
Huh?
We're giving him a B, I think.
A B. Okay, we'll give him a B. Fine, whatever.
Party pooper.
A. Give him an A.
No, B.
He didn't even know he was racing 3 days ago. Give him an A.
Fine, if you want to give him an A.
Look, it's just a nice A. He's not going to be there for the rest of the season. Yeah, it doesn't matter what his points are. Stroll, C.
Yeah. Really?
Lackluster performance, but it seemed like it was more down to the car, if anything, and just the tyres falling off a little bit as well for him towards the end.
Yeah, really disappointed with Racing Point. And it's really hard to judge because he didn't have a teammate in the race, so I think C is fair.
Raikkonen. What a torrid weekend he has had.
He took his time. Yeah, D or E. I mean, it was awful. Absolutely awful. His team radio was interesting, wasn't it?
Yeah, coming into the pits, and seemed like his engineer was rather scared of Kimi, if anything. Like, oh, okay, sorry. No, don't worry. Don't worry about it.
Interesting. Shows he's still got some fire in him, despite languishing in 17th. Still, obviously, you know, wants to do well and stuff. But
he's not going to do well for the next. Well, yeah, who knows where he's going to go or what he's going to do after? Is it this year? Isn't it his last? Is it like this year? Last year?
Yeah, this is his last year, which is a big shame, really, because he seems like he's just going to be one of those champions that just bows out in a rubbish car at the end and waves
goodbye.
That'd
be sad. That'd be very sad. I hope not. I hope he, I don't know, does another year in Alpha for a good. Who knows? But I think that's a solid F for Kimi in that one. He was getting passed by Latifi. That's
not
something.
A good look.
Yeah. Giovinazzi, E.
No, not an E, D.
No,
I
D?
Think D, yeah.
What's your reasoning?
Well, he was doing all right at that. What happened at the end? Because did he get a penalty at the end? Because he was ahead of people, and then I feel like he had a penalty or dropped right at the end. He's one of those people.
He had a safety
that...
car infringement or something, did he?
Oh, wow. Okay.
I feel like he had a safety car infringement.
That will be it. 5-second penalty at the end, I believe.
Yeah.
Which dropped him from just shy of the points behind like Russell and everyone. So, yeah, I think a D.
Okay, we'll give him a D then.
He needs to do more, doesn't he?
Magnussen.
So hard.
Difficult to judge, considering he was in the barriers at the start of the race.
How do you judge someone that makes a mistake on lap one?
D. We'll give him a D. Made a mistake, got punted off. Grosjean.
Oh, we've not even talked about Grosjean.
He stayed out, didn't he? He stayed out on the mediums. Just
he
chilling.
Finished.
Haas literally just rolling the dice with every strategy call they ever take now.
Yeah.
Like everyone's pitting. It's a free pit stop. Stay out, Roman. Stay out. Just in case we get another safety car in 20 laps time.
He finished dead last, didn't he, behind both Williams, right?
Because, he had to pit, didn't he? It's like, it was pointless, their strategy. But not much he could do.
I'm very surprised, correct me if I'm wrong, that nothing came of his second incident. Because for me, the first one with Sainz, that's a bit harsh. I know you weren't calling him a jerk. You were talking about
the jerk of the steering wheel.
Yes. The move on Sainz, personally, yes, it was a bit dodgy. But even as the Max Verstappen fanboy I am, he kind of does that every single race and doesn't get a black and white flag. So I thought that was maybe a little bit too harsh. But then the fact that he's got that black and white flag.
Did it again.
And then did it a lot worse with Ricciardo. That one was really sketchy, as Ricciardo, I think, even said himself on the radio. And there was no kind of, you're getting a penalty now. Which is very weird because it's like, what's the point of a black and white flag if saying don't do that again? And then he does it again worse and there's no kind of repercussion.
So there wasn't any repercussion for him because I was quite confused about that.
Yeah, I don't. Well, as far as I'm concerned, I don't remember seeing any kind of penalty or drive through or.
No, very strange. No,
it wasn't mentioned, and all right, well, give it's probably him an E. Not. Yeah, it probably doesn't do him much good when he's the chairman of the GPPA, which I think
association. Yeah, it's very.
And
odd,
he's got to be like, let me hear your thoughts. No weaving on the straight. No.
Yeah, because he was saying, oh, you know, my moves. You know, it needs to be written into the rule book if I can't do it. It's like.
Okay. I swear it was.
Yeah, I don't
I'm
know.
Sure it was.
Oh well, yeah, you otherwise you wouldn't have got a black and direction. White flag, surely. But oh well. So Grosjean E.
Yeah.
Russell, well, he got into Q2, so I'm going to give him a B.
He finished 12th. Yeah. Very, very close to points in the end.
But
I think
mainly because of DNFs and wasn't on pace, was it? They were. Oh no, because Russell got a five place. Was it a five place penalty?
Yeah, he did get a five place penalty.
Or was it? No, he started at the back, didn't he? I can't remember now.
He started not right at the back, but
a fair
way down.
Oh, actually, no, he would have started at the back because he was 15th or something, and he would have had a five-place penalty. So,
oh, yeah, okay.
He was right. He was on the back row of the grid, yeah.
But I guess
and that was because not slowing down for yellows because of his teammate crashing.
Which is not very smart because I think he would have made it anyway. I think he was up. So
he was on the bubble,
smart.
I think, wasn't he? Maybe, I think B's still fair.
Yeah, I agree.
I think he's still impressing. It's not a C performance, is it?
No, and A is a bit too high because he, let's be honest, he got 12th because the people behind him were his teammate, the Alphas that got penalties, and Grosjean, who obviously was nowhere with pitting. So,
absolutely. Nicholas Latifi?
D.
D?
C, D. He doesn't have much pace, really, did he? And
I think maybe C. Let's give him a C.
Yeah,
I don't think he's been that bad.
He's against Russell as well.
So, yeah. Let's give him a seat. Right, let's move on to our predictions then. What we predicted for Silverstone Grand Prix, at least one Ferrari out before Q3. Oops, is what I predicted, which was wrong. It was wrong, wasn't it?
Vettel didn't make it, did he? Or did he?
I think Vettel made it, didn't he?
I'm going to have to look into this now.
British... pre-qualified.
I don't feel like Vettel made it into Q3. Pretty sure he didn't. He did.
Yeah.
Oh, sorry. Sorry. Yes, of course. It was him that pit Gasly, was it?
Yeah. On the same. Was it the same? No, it wasn't. Q2. He did a 26.455. And it was Lance Stroll and Gasly that did the same time. So there you go. As much as I'd love to have a point, because you look like you wanted to give me one there.
no
Ferrari
time.
Out. Very close, but cigar. And Ocon beats Ricciardo. Wrong as well. Good one, Matt. Tommy, your two.
Oh, Mercedes Racing Point top four was completely wrong.
And this one you did get right, because screw you. It's the most generic thing I've ever seen.
Another threat of rain race. Yeah.
It was 60%, I think, when we got
60% qualifying, wasn't it? On
no, 60
before.
For the race.
Was
I think.
It? Oh my God.
I think, maybe.
Yeah. It's just one of those things, isn't it? Where raining at the water park, I'm sure it was.
Yeah. Give you a point anyway.
Go on, I'll have a point then.
Fans, Daniel Skews F1. Lewis says we have the best fans sat at home. No, he did not.
He did not. Hey.
And Fiona underscore Sprayer, Russell first point. No. That was a terrible week of predictions for us there. Silverstone again for the 70th anniversary Grand Prix predictions. My two, Hülkenberg DNF. I don't want it to happen.
Sad.
But I just feel like that's what the universe will bring. And Vettel out of the points. Because if his form is anything like it just was, he's going to finish outside the points. And he would have finished outside the points had Bottas not had his tyre blow up. So I think that's a fair prediction. Your two.
Sainz gets fourth this time.
Wow. Okay. Big prediction. Yeah.
Big prediction. And Pirelli bottle it and don't bring the softer tyres.
It says yawn. Says here commentators constantly talk about punctures in their.
Oh, I changed it. I changed it.
I changed it. Did you?
Yeah, I changed it.
Pirelli bottle soft tyres. I put on the document.
Yeah.
Lovely.
So obviously we mentioned it and we knew the one. Yeah.
Even though they were slower than Renault this weekend. Interesting.
Yeah, I think he'll pull it out of the bag. But we'd not really mentioned that the next. I think we did on another podcast a while back, but they're meant to be bringing softer tyres.
Yeah, a step
and now softer. Now with the punctures, and it's meant to be hotter as well.
It is supposed to be like 32 degrees, I think, this weekend.
And with the tyre blowouts, unfortunately, however much I'd love to, because in my opinion, I don't know about yours, is the teams just need to pit more if they're going to blow up.
Yes.
But
it's not a case of tyre failure, it's just wear and
yeah.
Maybe combine that with a bit of debris. Let's have a two-stop, please. That would be nice. Then we get some strategies and some different tyre compounds, and that would be lovely, wouldn't it?
It would.
Right, fans, Baldy Mark 05, three-stop strategies. I don't think it'll be a three-stop.
Three-stop would be extreme.
I think they'll push a two. Some people were messaging me saying five-stop strategies because of the hot weather and softer tyres. No. Unless it's a 200-lap race. An RSU official, no Mercedes on the podium. My God, I want to be giving a point out for that one. But I don't think I will be.
That's a bold prediction if we've ever seen one.
Indeed. Right, we're done. We're finished. WTF1 podcast over. Tommy, any more thoughts?
No, let's hope the race is as good as it was at the end all the way through. 10 stops. I want a 2012 F1 race where everyone's pitting every 10 laps. Different strategies, different tyre compounds. But I think
sign
probably I'll bottle it and bring the old tyres instead.
No! Please. Are they allowed to? I guess on safety measures
we'll
they're allowed
find
to.
Out. Yeah, probably.
But don't do it. The teams will just do the same thing. They'll just try and one stop and they'll blow up again and it'll be hotter. So, I don't know. Anyway, that is it. We are done. Thank you very much, Tommy. I'm waving at you right now. Goodbye. Take care of yourself. We've got another, obviously, we've got the 70th anniversary. I don't know why I'm still waving and talking. 70th anniversary race, and then we have a week's break.
No, we don't. Another,
wait, what?
Triple header, isn't it? Silverstone, Spain.
Oh, yeah.
In a row.
Then why have you put it on the sheet? You know I'm Ron Burgundy.
That was from the last week. Is it still
for
on
God's,
there?
Yeah, it's still there. I said it and I was like, I don't think that's true, but I'm going to say it anyway and see what happens. God's sake, Tommy. Oh, and you've also written, Tommy is a sexy man. No, you haven't. But anyway, right, it's not a week's break. Screw you, we've just had a week's break.
Yeah, I was going to say.
It's fine, nobody watches this part of the podcast anyway. Yeah, right, thank you so much, everybody, for watching. Tommy, screw you for putting that in the sheet. I'm still waving at you. And we'll see you all next time. I'm Matt Gallagher. He's just put in the sheet as well. Right, bye, guys.
Bye, bye.
I've just spilt it down my top. Oh, you've definitely got some great content of me just spilling juice down my t-shirt.
That's another little Easter egg for the end.
That can go, yeah. Oh, God, that went absolutely everywhere.